of Daniel, if you will, please, this morning. I believe that we're now ready for chapter 3. We did look at chapter 7 because they do correlate quite a bit. So we'll be looking at Daniel chapter 3 this morning. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, made an image of gold. Interesting that we had an image situation before, and we have him praising the God of heaven, and what does he turn around and do? Builds an image. But notice, if you will, whose height was 70 cubits, and the breadth of it 6 cubits. It's set up in the plain of Dura in the prince of Babylon, province of Babylon. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king sent to gather together the princes, the governors, the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. To say the least, this is quite an event. This is an international excursion. It would have taken, I don't know how much time to have put all of this together, to get all of these people. Think of all these provinces this empire covered. All the rulers. Fathom that for a minute. Okay, this is quite an undertaking. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set out. And an herald cried out, "To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages, that at the time that you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music." Now, I'm not going to repeat those again and again, okay? "Ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king hath set up." Now, you have to understand that Nebuchadnezzar is a dedicated worshiper of Marduk. That was the popular god at the time. You remember in chapter 1, he would offer his food to demons before they would eat. So understand what's going on in Nebuchadnezzar's head, okay? And understand that this is not physical, it's spiritual. It's a spiritual attack. and yet it's a great opportunity for victory. Now notice, "And whosoever falleth not down and worshipeth, shall the same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace." Now understand, that thing had to be built and stoked up ahead of time. Right? Mm-hmm. It's already built. It's already stoked up here for this time. So they're anticipating. Now if anybody doesn't worship, here's going to be the penalty. So here's your image, and here's the furnace. You getting the picture? It isn't you're invited, and if you would like to come. No. This is a international, state-enforced, and by force, worship. Okay? You get an invitation with a furnace at the bottom of it. That's what you get here. Okay? "Therefore, at the time when all the people heard the sound of the instruments and all kinds of music, all the people, nations, languages fell down, worshiped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar king had set up. Wherefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews." Now, they're going to do this for several reasons. One's political, of course. If they can get rid of these Jews and get them out of the way, they get promotion. So there's political implications. So it's an occasion, I'm sure, that it was personal. There had to be envy. Hey, we're Chaldeans, and here these Jews have been put over us. Remember at the end of chapter 2 where Daniel was made the next in line and he promoted these three Well, they got promoted above nationals, Chaldeans. And these Chaldeans have to answer to these three. I'm sure they're not liking that. And notice they spoke and said unto the king, O king, live forever. May as well throw a little sugar on. Thou, O king, hast made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the instruments and worship the gold, it shall fall down, worship the golden image. Now here's the tattletale part. Now couldn't they have gotten along in their life without this? More than likely. Would the king have ever caught it? Who knows? You got to understand what a massive crowd this must have been. Okay? And whoever falleth not down and worshipeth, that he should be cast into the midst of a burning fire. Didn't you say that? Isn't that what you said? All right, these are certain Jews whom thou hast set over thee. Notice how they present them. Remember these Jews you set over the affairs. You know, couldn't they have just said, well, there's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They don't seem to be following the rules. No, these Jews. These Jews that's been set over us and over the affairs. And notice how they're described. So you can see the envy, right? This is political and it's personal. There's envy here. It's like what Pilate says concerning Pilate. Pilate knew that for envy they brought Jesus to him. Right? You see that with Joseph, his brothers. They became envious. Here he's the son of the second wife, and he's been put to supervise us. And he's got this beautiful coat of many colors. We're going to eliminate this. We're going to throw him in a pit. And he told us we're going to bow down to him. That's never going to happen. And on and on and on. You know how that story went. Turns out they did bow down to him. He was the second ruler in Egypt. And they had better give him honor or they're not going to eat. Yeah, but okay, you can see the indignation. I want you I don't want you to pass over that. Whom thou hast set over the affairs of the providence of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these men, they're going to point them out. Okay, O king, have not regarded thee. Oh, they made it personal to the king. Right? Is that true? That's a lie. That's not true. They had respect for the boss. They just have no respect for worshiping idols. All right. So now we've got them set up. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Praise the Lord. This is where the enemy is complimenting the faith of God's people. Hey, they don't worship. We knew they wouldn't worship. We knew it. We got them. They don't worship our gods, and we know that. It's kind of like when they accused the apostles when they brought them the second time. You filled Jerusalem with your gospel. We told you not to do that. And you remember what Peter said? Well, whether that's to be done or not, know that we are his witnesses, and we can't do anything but that. You're out of luck. All right. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Now, understand, you don't defy a king. And these are the homeboys. These aren't guys that came from somewhere else. Mm-hmm. These are people in his direct administration. Mm-hmm. Right? And did that in front of everybody. Remember, he's invited all these people. From all over, all the rulers of languages and peoples. And here's these three guys not bowing down. The ones that he promoted. Not a good moment politically. Not a good moment. All right, notice these men. And notice in verse 13, fury commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Now, let me tell you that there's favor here in this rage. And so, Pastor Ted, how do you figure that? He could have offed them without meeting them. Nebuchadnezzar had that kind of power. Don't think about like what we have today in our system, due process. There's no due process. There's no due process here. He's a totalitarian. If he says off with his head, then it's off with his head. And you don't hesitate either, by the way, or it might be your head. That's kind of how that works. So understand what this means. There's favor here. He's going to give him a second chance in front of everybody. Okay? Now notice, then Nebuchadnezzar in his rage. Now verse 14. Nebuchadnezzar spoke and said unto them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego?" Now, isn't that an interesting question? "Do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up?" Why is he asking? He's already had witnesses. Didn't these guys come and accuse? Now, you know what I think? He knew those guys. He knew how they were. You know, he knew how they were. And I think, even bad bosses want good people working for them. Did you know that? Yeah. And I think that he knew those three, and I think he counted on the three of them. So in a sense, he's being gracious here. Is that true? And notice in verse 15. Now, here's what we're going to do, fellas. I'm going to bring in the orchestra, and we're going to try this again. So notice, now, if ye be ready, that at that time that ye hear the sound of the instruments and all kinds of music, to fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, but if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Now, if he would have stopped right there, this is bad enough. But notice how where he goes. He trespasses here, transgresses. "And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands?" Whew, what a statement he's making. He's putting himself up pretty high, isn't he? Higher than the God Almighty. "Your God's not going to deliver you out of my hands. See that furnace over there? You're not going to get past that." Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said unto the king, "We want a lawyer." No, that wouldn't have done them any good. They don't look for representation. I want you to notice what they don't do. They don't play politics. They're not going to be politically correct today. Okay? They make no excuses. I want you to notice that in their response. And they stand for God. No hesitation. They don't say, "Well, now let's counsel together. Why don't we just go along with this? And it'll all be out." Wouldn't that be the easy way out? Wouldn't it? "Look, let's just go along with this. Everybody knows where we stand anyway. Let's take the easy way out. Let's please everybody. Let's just get along here. Let's not make a scene." Right? Let me read you something. I'm doing this for time's sake. Let me read you something from the book of Hebrews. Chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. We have a similar situation from Moses. By faith, verse 21 of Hebrews 11. "By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter." Now, think about that for a minute. Now, couldn't he free Israel from the throne? Right? I mean, there's options here. Let's understand that. There's options. He's next in line to be the Pharaoh of Egypt. You know, somewhere down the line, he could kind of exile these folks out. He could make good political argument. Hey, do we want these guys dwelling in the middle of us, and then enemies come and maybe conspire with them? I mean, he could come up with some good reasons. Couldn't he take the easy way out? Right? Couldn't he get the same thing done? But notice, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. No, come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord, and I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, and I will dwell in the midst of you, and ye shall be my people, and I will be thy God. Nope, not an option, not for Moses. He's moving by faith, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Now, let's stop off in the book of Ephesians for a moment. The book of Ephesians, chapter 6. And let's think about Ephesians chapter 6 here for just a minute. There's three things you must do. One, you must be strong in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Two, you must take the whole armor of God. And what's the third one? Stand. In chapter 6, verse 12, did you know that Gettysburg was won by one man? Battle of Gettysburg was won by one man. That's right. The end of the line on Little Round Top Hill was guarded by a colonel from, I forget what state. I'll think of it when I get on 23. That's how that always works. I think it was Maryland, but I'm not sure. And he was told, you're the end of the line. You can't leave. You can't leave. Or the Southern Army goes over the hill and they march right on into Washington. You're the end of the line. Now, I do believe that they didn't think that the Southern Army would go up hills to attack. They were thinking the middle, which they did later, and that didn't work out too well either. And that's where the attack came. You know, and battles are hard enough, and they kept flanking them, and they had to keep bringing in the reserves and lengthening the line. And you know what else happened? They ran out of ammo. And the colonel called the officers, them that were left, together, and he said, well, put your bayonets on, we're going to charge. We don't have any ammo, and we can't leave. We're not going to just stand up here and get shot. So we're going to swing half of our unit down this way, and then swing the middle down on top of that, and we're going to chase them down the hill. One man won that battle. They did not succeed that day. And the next day, they decided to try to charge through the middle. And we know how all that happened and how all that worked out. Terrible. 50,000 fell, as many as in Vietnam. 50,000 fell in one day, Gettysburg. One day. Okay, one guy. I'm going to explain the point. You ready? Having done all to stand, we're told to be strong in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Take all the armor of God, and having done all to stand. So look in for chapter 6, verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. It's not Nebuchadnezzar. This is spiritual. But against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the wicked darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And boy, that's what we got going on here. And the prize is a fiery furnace, which, by the way, God does not keep them from. Which in turn, God uses to prove who is the God of gods. Nebuchadnezzar, you got one a-coming. God is able to deliver them out of your hand. But that's what's going on here. Wouldn't it be a great day if these guys fold? They fold to idolatry. God's remnant, the faithful ones, they're targeted. Why are they targeted? Because of who they worship. Right? These Jews, they don't worship your God, Nebuchadnezzar. They didn't fall down now. You see what's going on here? Oh, I think they did it for political reasons. I don't think they gave a hoot who worshiped who that day. They just wanted position, to be honest with you. He had the same thing with those that accused Daniel concerning the lion's den. But now notice, they couldn't find anything wrong with him at his work and with his jobs. They had to find fault somehow to get rid of him. And notice in verse 13, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to what? To be able to withstand in the evil day. This is an evil day here. This is an evil day. Having done all to stand. And that's exactly what these three guys do. They stand. Moses chose to what? Suffer with the people of God and enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. They've got options. Who knows why? But they even got a second chance. Now look, understand what's happening here. This is happening in front of everyone. He didn't send everybody home. Can you imagine being called up like that in front of everybody? All right, boys, now we're going to play we're going to get the symphony in here, and we're going to play the music one more time. Here's your chance. Oh, would that be easy? Right? Play along, be politically correct. Right? No. No, that's not how faith moves. No. And now notice, so I want you to see how the battle lines are drawn here in Daniel. This is in front of everybody. And this is exactly what God allowed to happen. No, not Nebuchadnezzar's put them there. No, not the accusers. God has. God has allowed this to happen. There's going to be a showdown here. Let me read you something from the book of Acts, chapter 2, for a minute. Acts chapter 2. We can get carried away in an evil day and want to blame this person and that person. No, God's ordained this. He's got a purpose in it, a sovereign purpose. Notice what Peter preaches in Acts chapter 2, verse 22. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know. You know, you were there, you saw. You saw the same thing we did. And notice, him being delivered by the Jews. No. Him being delivered by Pilate. No. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain. Oh, he doesn't leave them off the hook. They had their part in it, right? But who allowed this to happen? God. He determined it according to the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. And the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God has allowed this to happen. And you might say, well, this just ain't fair. These guys have done everything right. They've lived for the Lord. They've been a testimony. They have entrusted positions in this kingdom. Oh, this is just awful. Now notice, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter. It reminds me of Peter and John, doesn't it, you? Whether it's right or not concerning you, we can't but speak in this name as we are his witnesses. That's going to be your problem. It's not our problem. And that's kind of what these guys are saying. Oh, and I want you to notice, no hesitation. They don't go and, okay, let's huddle. Let's figure this out. Oh, no, there's no hesitation. We're not careful to answer thee. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king, one way or the other. Ah, how do you like that for faith? Right? I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Remember when they came to test the Lord, the Sadducees? And he says, you do greatly err, not knowing the scriptures or the power of God. Right? The resurrection of God. He's the God of the living, not the dead. Okay, now notice. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve the gods nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. I want you to understand what these three just did. They just signed their life away. There's no way they can know that they're not going into the furnace and that they're not going to be consumed in the next few minutes. We will not worship this way and we will not serve. And that is what the Word of God says. Remember when Satan said, if you will fall down and worship me, all this shall be thine. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. That's what that first commandment teaches. The very first commandment. So it's not only the God of heaven, but it's also the law of God is on trial here by the remnant. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Now verse 19. Then was Nebuchadnezzar, he's beside himself. These rascals, how could they do that to me? I could just, this king is so mad, I bet he was tempted to take him on himself. All right, now notice. From his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They went from favor in the kingdom to fiery furnace in about a second. Okay? So now notice. Therefore, he spoke and commanded that they should heat the furnace. I mean, it would have been hot enough as it was. Heat that thing up, there's no chance. They weren't going to have a chance. Seven times hotter. Now, I don't know what that might have been like. I don't think they had temperature gauges back then. I don't know. Let's just say that anything touching that's done for. How about that? And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. These guys are not getting away. There's no getting out of this. To cast them into the... Wouldn't it be enough just to cast them in there? Oh no, they're going to cast them bound in there. Right? I mean, you cast them in there, they're not going to make it anyhow. How can they get back out? I mean, they can't. So but he's going to cast them bound in there. That's how malicious this gets. Then these men were bound in their coats, their stockings, and their turbans, and their garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. No doubt it was a dressy occasion. Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent and the furnace exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire slew these men that took them there. Can you imagine that? You talk about rage. Boy, that furnace wasn't the only one on fire. This king was on fire, wasn't he? All right. Then these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down, bound into the midst of the burning, fiery furnace. I want you to take note of that description. It's important. Are they getting out of this? Does God rescue them from the fiery furnace? No. It wasn't his desire that they be rescued from the fiery furnace. Let's look in the book of 1 Peter for just a moment. God has a purpose in such things. Look in the book of 1 Peter. I want to read from 1 Peter chapter 1. And it says, "In this ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold trials. That the trial of your faith being more precious than that of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with what? Fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ." What? Yeah. Fire. Some through the water, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Yeah, it's God's design. It's God's design. And understand that we get a complete picture. It didn't say they threw them in there and they shut the door and forgot about them. No, they were bound and they were put in the middle of the thing. Okay, so we make no mistake about that. They're going to go in this furnace. God doesn't send angels and rescue them. Not like with Daniel with Belshazzar, where the Medo-Persians kill the king, and well, that's the end of that. Nope, that's not happening here. All right, then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astounded and rose up in haste and spoke unto his counselors, "Did not we cast three men bound?" Now, they must have been able to look into it. And I'm not sure how that could be. Did they actually have actual windows? I'm not sure windows would have helped with it that hot. I can't, maybe just openings. There might have been like venting in it. I don't know, but he can see in. Okay, he can see in. "And rose up in haste and spoke and said to his counselors, 'Did not we cast three men bound into the midst of?'" they couldn't have threw them in. They ran back out. No, they were bound. Okay, they're not going anywhere, all right? "Into the midst of the fire, and they answered and said unto the king, 'True, O king.'" Yeah, that's what we did. You betcha. Mm-hmm. "And he answered and said, 'Lo, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, no harm. And the form of the fourth is like the son of the gods.'" We have trouble in Image City. Right? Now imagine, and by the way, this is done in front of all the people, mm-hmm, tongues and nation. Yeah, the Jews said, "Now we've crucified Jesus and we've put him in a tomb sealed with soldiers. That takes care of that." Well, no, there's a little earthquake and an angel rolls the stone away and sits on the top of it and the clothes are folded neatly. Mm-hmm. He's not here. He is risen as he said. Man's not going to have the final say, friends. Impossible as it may be, bound in this furnace, that's impossible. Now notice, then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spoke and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, what? Kind of reminds you of Darius, doesn't it? Daniel, is thy God whom thou servest continually? Oh, what a testimony. Is he able to deliver you from the mouth of the lions? Mm-hmm. Now, if I was Daniel, I'd wait a little while. Let the old boy sweat it for a minute. But Daniel, he didn't do that. Now, notice if you will. Notice the testimony. Ye servants of who? The Most High God. Now, I want you to think about what he just said and go back over here to chapter 3 and in verse 16, the last sentence. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Huh? He stoked that furnace up 7 times. And he threw them in there bound. Huh? Mm-hmm. Now notice this acknowledgement. Ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come here. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth from the midst of the fire. I might have been tempted to say, well, you threw us in, come get us out. But Peter did that in Philippi, remember? Mm-hmm. Because he was a citizen. Well, now, you threw me in here without due process. Now, you come get me out. Remember that? But now notice, if you will. And the princes at sea, everybody's there. Nobody's left. All those people that were assembled to come here that day to do this thing, they're still there. He's not dismissed them. He's made a public show of these guys. And notice, and the princes, governors, captains, and the king's counselors being gathered together saw these men whose bodies the flame had no power, nor was an hair of their head singed, neither were their coats changed, nor the smell of the fire, as if they had never been there. Now that's the reality of the situation. This isn't something virtual on the internet or a little show game you play. No. As if they'd never been in that furnace. Untouched. And notice, though, nor even the smell of it. And then Nebuchadnezzar spoke and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach. I guess he can't beat them, join them. Right? He thought he had got he had it covered. He bound them. He threw them in the middle of the thing. They've turned her up 7 times hotter. And notice, if you will, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who hath sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. Do you see that? Having done all to stand, what did they prove? Their trust in the Most High God. Remember what they say. If God does not deliver us, know this, O King, he's able to. And no, we're not going to worship. No, we're not going to bow down. Because the law of our God says you're not to bow down to any image. You're not to worship anything in heaven or on earth, only God. So we're not bound down today. You may as well send the symphony on their way with all kinds of music. It's not going to happen. Now notice, if you will, and change the king's word. Now I want you to notice these next words. And yielded their what? bodies, that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Now, he's still not quite getting it. He's the God of gods and the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I am God, and beside me there is none else. Now, Israel had not lived up to that. That's why there's no respect here by these kings. But there is today, this evil day, there is today. And notice, therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, language who speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a refuge heap, because there's no other God that can deliver after this sort. Can't get past it. No, this was not a mistake, going into this fiery furnace. These three guys did what the nation should have been doing all of those years of apostasy. Right? Now, yielded their bodies. Turn with me, if you will, please. Actually, I'm out of time, just when we're warming up, to the book of Romans. Chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. Chapter 12, verse 1. It says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a what? Yielded their bodies. A living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your spiritual, worshipful service. And be not what? Conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I'd say mission accomplished, wouldn't you? Uh-huh. Having done all to stand. All right, let's end with a word of prayer, please. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we praise you this morning for this tremendous picture. And fathers, we'll be studying the details of it. Father, give us your grace. And Father, we thank you to have the privilege of being servants of the Most High God in an everlasting kingdom that shall never know no end. And Father, we thank you for our King of kings and Lord of lords, Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you for that blessed promise that we see from the Great Commission. Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end. And Father, we thank you for this blessed lesson this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.